greatest gambling story ever told. A true tale of three gamblers, the Kentucky Derby, and the Mexican Cartel. By Mark Paul. Narrated for you by Will Damron. Dedication. To my wife, partner, and love of my life, who always believes in me, often for no apparent reason. Chapter 1. Long-Legged Lady. May 5th, 1984. Churchill Downs Racetrack, Kentucky. A girl with long red hair, perhaps 8 years old, was sitting high atop her father's shoulders, watching the horses load into the gate for the 110th running of the Kentucky Derby. They were standing in the packed grandstand at the stretch near the starting gate. Nearly a quarter mile separated them and the finish line. She was holding a sign that read, "Beat the boys, Althea!" She wanted to see a female horse win the prestigious race, something that a filly had accomplished only twice since 1875. This filly, Althea, had drawn the dreaded rail post position. She was calm when she entered the gate. Althea was waiting behind the gate because 19 additional horses were still to be loaded into the starting gates, including another female. The other filly, Life's Magic, shared the same trainer as Althea, D. Wayne Lucas. The betting public believed the two fillies had a real chance. They were the favorites at odds of only 2.8 to 1, coupled in the wagering together. After the outside gate, number 20, was loaded, the starter's bell rang and the gates sprung open. The crowd of 126,000 fans roared as Althea broke just a bit slow, but recovered and frantically dug her hooves into the hard brown Kentucky soil, desperate to get in front of the other 19 charging horses. She was sprinting now, taking the lead running, while on the inside part of the track near the white rail, past the fans, and into the first of the two long turns. The red-haired girl's father yelled, "Althea's in front!" She smiled and shouted, "Go, girl! Go, girl!" A horse named Swale, a colt, was the one most expected to battle the favored Althea, at 3-1 odds, and he settled just off the speeding filly on the lead as they charged into the turn at nearly 40 miles per hour. With the sound of 80 hooves pounding into the track, all horses were seeking the immortality of a Derby win for their trainers and owners. Althea now opened up on Swale by 1.5 lengths into the first left-handed turn. The 71-year-old trainer of Swale was Woody Stevens of Kentucky, and like many successful older men, he had lost his politically correct filter some years before. Just that morning, he had yelled to Lucas, "Damn it, Wayne, keep your fillies out of my way." "Althea won't be in your way, Woody. You'll have to catch her if you can." "You're wasting your time. Keep the girls running against girls." Lucas had been the first trainer in history to enter two fillies in the same Derby. He had been mocked and criticized by other trainers, the media, and many racing fans for doing so, despite how Althea had defeated the colts in three other major stakes races already in her short career. To win a Derby requires a different type of horse, a horse that can race the classic distance of 1.25 miles and survive the long stretch run against the best horse flesh on the planet. Just before the start of this race, a male fan yelled, "You're going to lose again, Wayne. Next year, bring a colt." So far, in the 1984 Kentucky Derby, Lucas looked like a genius as Althea led the thundering pack into the backstretch. Hooves pounding, Swale and Althea were throwing back chunks of dirt into the faces of their nearest pursuers, nearly two lengths behind them. Swale began his attack on her outside right flank, challenging her for the lead. She felt his energy and dug in again, accelerating into the final turn, flatly refusing to yield to the larger colt on her outside. The huge, raucous crowd had wagered $25 million, and the anticipated battle between the two betting favorites was on. Now the red-haired girl could see the horses charging directly toward her position near the rail at the start of the stretch. "Come on, Althea! You can do it, girl!" Swale was running easily under his champion jockey Lafitte Pincai Jr., while Chris McCarran on Althea was furiously pumping his arms forward, urging the smaller filly to keep the battle going. She fought gamely to hold the second position as Swale rushed past, but the colts were making their ambitious stretch assaults now. The other filly, Life's Magic, was caught in a wall of horses and making no impact. Pinkai, one of the most physically powerful riders in history, urged Swale forward with his piston-like arms, matching in exact rhythm the colt's giant strides as they surged away from the field. Althea was spent from her early race speed. McCarran, feeling her fatigue beneath him, did not draw his whip. She lapsed to 5th, then 10th, then 15th, exhausted. At the wire, Althea beat only one horse that had been pulled up earlier in the race. She finished over 30 lengths behind the winning Swale and his celebrating trainer, Woody Stevens. Lucas watched as Althea finished 19th after Life's Magic came in 8th. Despite winning 131 races and smashing the all-time money-won record for a single racing season, Lucas had failed for the 6th consecutive time in the world's most well-known horse race. July 17, 1986, Keeneland Racetrack, Lexington, Kentucky. 2 years after that race, the San Diego Chargers helmet logo stood tall on the tail of a gleaming private jet as it banked hard over Keeneland Racetrack in Lexington, Kentucky. Trainer D. Wayne Lucas loved this part of horse racing, the private jets and traveling with billionaires who were committed to buying the best horse flesh in the world. Tall, lean, and fit, with gray hair and designer sunglasses, he looked every bit the Hollywood movie star. Many movie stars aren't tough, but Lucas was a former bareback bronco rodeo rider and raced quarter horses as a jockey when young. He had been a rock-hard cowboy who came up through the ranks, training first on the rodeo circuit and then the cheap track quarter horse circuit from the Midwest to Texas and then on to Southern California. He had spent years sleeping in the beds of pickup trucks and shaving with cold water in front of side view mirrors. He had come from nowhere and was now the dominant thoroughbred racehorse trainer in the world. Billionaire Eugene Klein was a man used to winning by playing aggressively and now competed with the best racehorse owners in the game in the richest possible stakes races. In recent years, Klein had sold his Seattle Supersonics NBA team, his San Diego Chargers NFL team, and his other considerable business interests to focus on a new passion, thoroughbred horse racing. The private plane's flight attendants were former Chargers cheerleaders, who were stunning in their short skirts and white blouses. Both blonde and nearly as tall in heels as Lucas himself, they were used to being chatted up by passengers, but Lucas seemed not to notice them. Lucas was as handsome a guest as they had ever served, other than a few of the Chargers players, and they tried to catch Lucas's attention. He was oblivious to their flirtations. Lucas was looking to see what other private planes were already on the ground. As the plane taxied on the tarmac, Lucas pointed out to Klein some of the private jets owned by bidding competitors already on site. The largest of the jets dwarfed all the other planes. It belonged to Sheikh Mohammed bin Rashid Al Maktoum, the defense minister of Dubai. Oil money was a different kind of money. It escalated competition at the horse auctions. The sheikhs of Dubai, who were also there, were led by another horseman with the status of Lucas, the handsome and always impeccably dressed European, Robert Sangster. The sheikhs were nicknamed the Doobie Brothers. Also parked front and center on the tarmac was the jet of Greek shipping magnate Stavros Niarchos. Stavros was born in Athens to a wealthy family, and by boldly investing $2 million into a shipping business, he now was the richest magnate in the world. His personal history included 4 wives, each considerably younger than the first. Lucas knew that this was going to be an epic Keeneland sales auction of prime horse flesh. He was out of his seat before the plane stopped, standing at the door, waiting for it to be opened. A man of immense energy, he was up at 3 a.m. every day to train and watch his horses. By 5 a.m., he was on the phone to his people in Florida, Kentucky, or Southern California, and all the other barns where he kept stables of the fastest racehorses in the world. At the auction today, he wanted to inspect the young horses on the block.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.